It is a joy to be with you again. This being with you, I'm asked to be, and I'm grateful for your prayers, your presence, and your will, blessings, and gifts, and calls to the hospital. Really miss being here for Ash Wednesday and worship last Sunday. I'm thankful to Megan Mitchell and the staff at the Ash Wednesday services go for the little guy that worship last Sunday. And again, it's just a blessing to you. I was not with you to know that. Especially your prayers. Thank you for supporting me and all. And again, it's just a blessing to be with you again. Blessing to share this time of worship the second Sunday of Lent. Thank you for being here again, especially those guests and listeners who may be with us. Just a reminder, we've got registration pads in our pews of the office for us to know and share in worship here at First Church. As we gather, we are mindful of the ministries of the church, especially the clothes closet and food bank. Yesterday, our clothes closet served 214 people, and with the food bank, 113 boxes were packed to serve 394 people. It was wonderful to have both these ministries operate. Now we have ministries there yesterday. We're still not fully there yet as far as the food bank, but again, that was the center of these ministries yesterday. Thanks for all the leadership and the volunteers, and for your gifts to get these ministries happening. As we move into this week, I look forward to being with you on Tuesday evening, live. A Lent study in which we're going to look at some movie clips of recent years and see how these various pieces of cinema lend to faith conversation, especially in the season of Lent, about the experiences that we see on screen, also rub shoulders with our own experiences of faith. So again, 6 o'clock Tuesday evening, a light meal from 6 to 6:30, and then our time of conversation with faith from 6:30 to about 7:30. All are welcome to be in the fellowship hall. I look forward to seeing you then. And keep these ministries in your prayer as we gather in worship next Sunday. Megan and Paul and Bob are youth of the Equal Hybrid Church. So our prayers go to Megan and our youth. They will leave on Friday and come sometime on Sunday afternoon. So we're excited for this time of retreat for our youth and their leadership. And I want you to know that. We begin a worship theme today, meeting Jesus at table. So now, throughout the season of Lent, even beyond Easter, we want to look at some of the scenes in our scriptures that speak of the importance of table. Some amazing and powerful experiences are before us as Jesus interacts with people at table. I look forward to sharing that time of worship with you. And with that before us, I invite us to stand and share in our hall. The ways of death in this world are many.
The words of death surround us.
The fear of death envelops us.
But we come now to hear a different word.
A true word.
A life-giving word.
You hear from Isaiah's mouth.
Where tears are white.
turn away from you. You never rejected us. You spoke words of mercy and love through the prophets, promising to swallow up death forever and to host a banquet for all people, a feast of life-giving sustenance. We praise you for Christ Jesus, your word incarnate made flesh. Born of Mary, he shares our life. Eating with sinners, he welcomes us. Leading his followers, he guides us. Dying on the cross, he rescues us. Risen from the dead, he gives new life. Most gracious God, source of all that it is, we give you thanks for your unspeakable gift of Christ Jesus. Amen.
behind you, to your right, to your left. Because we're going to be projecting some images, I'm going to ask for your help in identifying these images, okay? All right, there's our first one. Anyone tell me what you see there? A picnic table. And when might we enjoy a picnic table? church and their families and leadership prepared for us an amazing meal, an amazing display of welcome and service, hospitality. Not only this, we remember that joining us for worship and at table that Sunday were Hugh Gerlach and family. Hugh, we know in recent months, has suffered life-threatening illness and lengthy hospitalization, but he has made a remarkable recovery. Hugh and his family worshiped with us that Sunday. They were a part of the great gathering for lunch in the ministry center. Hugh taking the microphone and expressing his appreciation, and also having happy birthday, some of the occasion as well. Now, I'm grateful for the memories of that Sunday, and I find it appropriate to set those memories before us this morning as we begin this worship series, which speaks of meeting Jesus at table. For so much of that Sunday, remember, had table at its center. As we worshiped that morning, we gathered at table, sharing in the bread and the cup of the Lord's Supper. We then moved to the ministry center, again the table, many tables, as a matter of fact, at the center of our gathering, the center of conversation, of fellowship, being united as the body of Jesus Christ. Arising from all of this, the celebration of our life is Christ's church, the witness to healing. And at the center of it all, the table. You see, Christ meets us more than once and in more than one way at table, and we really cannot stray from the table and understand fully our relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, we know that for some time here at First Church, we have offered the ministry of lunch bunch every Tuesday and Thursday morning. This means that in our fellowship hall, a meal is provided on these days for anyone, really, primarily for the needy, the hungry, the unemployed, the homeless. Now, I try as often as I can on these Tuesdays and Thursdays to go from my office to the fellowship hall, to thank those serving the meal that day, and to speak with our guests. Now, while this is not the most difficult of things to do, I confess to you, it's a practice I have discovered it's not as easy as it sounds, because I'm never sure of the response that I may receive. Now, there are those whom I have come to know who greet me and welcome me and are happy to see me. And there are those who haven't met me before, who may understandably be unsure about what you're doing here. There are those guests who may be hesitant to make eye contact with me, suggesting to me they prefer to eat in private without interruption. I understand totally. There are those who, while appreciating the meal and hospitality at the same time, may be embarrassed to have come to this place in life where they depend upon meals offered by the church. So you understand? Amongst these varied guests, there's not just one response, and often I'm conflicted as to how to greet our guests. I want to introduce myself to you, to welcome you, but I also wish to respect your desire to eat and privacy. I want to welcome you and make sure what you have what you need, but I also wish to be sensitive to the fact that this may be a humbling experience. More than once, I've left the fellowship hall second-guessing the response I offered our lunch bunch guests. Should have been more assertive, say to myself. Perhaps you should have spoken to that man. Then I wait the next Tuesday or Thursday. Now this is when I do well to remember the witness of the gospel as it's before us this morning. You see, in the confusion, in the uncertainty, in the awkwardness, in the second guessing, God is still at work. Because the hungry are being fed, God is present in the midst of all of this. In the midst of trying best to gauge how to show hospitality to those who have need, in the awkward social dances that often accompany our gracious efforts, in the uncertainty of it all, in the second guessing of these efforts, God's at work. For this is the God who sets himself firmly in the midst of those with whom no one else may socialize. This is the God who is friend to the stranger, host to the lonely, advocate to the humble. This is the God who eats with sinners, meaning he eats who believe it inappropriate that Jesus eats with sinners. I wonder if we've ever stepped back and wonder why they find this so offensive. Remember, no offense is taken at the idea of business transactions with sinners. No offense is taken at the idea of doing commerce with sinners, but eating with sinners. Unacceptable. So what is it that happens at table that happens nowhere else? What is the threat that is known when Jesus sits at table with sinners? I attended a continuing education at the clergy, a seminary from which I graduated in Richmond several years ago. I don't remember the particular area of focus for the day. I don't remember the names of the lectures. But I remember one simple sentence spoken in the course of the day by one of the lecturers. The sentence was this: people don't resist change. They resist false. Again, people don't resist change. They resist false. So why are these words stuck with me through the years? Why are they words I find unforgettable? Because I've known life in church, as you have, and known that we seem never to travel too far without speaking of the difficulty of enacting change within the church. At times we may shake our heads at the church's difficulty in embracing change. At other times, we may grieve the conflict that arises if even the slightest of change is introduced within the church. Though conversations regarding change have been frequent and difficult, I have never considered that the issue really is not change. It's loss. What we've been slow to admit is the reality that change brings about false. That's what people resist. Now, if there could be change without false, change may not be a troublesome issue. In other words, if we could have change and everything remained the same, not a problem. But change, moving from one state of life to another, involves leaving something behind. That's what we resist. Not only within the church. People don't resist change. False. Perhaps I remember these words because they seem to me as words that live at the center of the ministry of Jesus. True, we bustle the authorities for their hard hearts, for their rejection of Jesus. But consider all the change Jesus initiates. You have heard it said, but I say to you, your sins are forgiven. Rise and walk. Blessed are those who mourn, those who hunger, those who thirst for righteousness. He's not like everyone else, they say. He teaches as one with authority. Do we see how different life is once Jesus shows up?
No.
Do we see how much Jesus changes life? In other words, do we see how much loss we know if we make room for Jesus, if we take him seriously? I begin to understand the resistance of the authorities as they fuss at Jesus. I begin to understand their ugly remarks. This Jesus is a serious threat to life as we've always known it. This is no more true than when Jesus takes his place at table. Sinners. Remember, interacting with sinners on various social levels? No problem. Do commerce, engage in business? No problem there. Eating with sinners. We enter into different territory here. We enter into the unknown, and it is scary. People don't resist change, they resist loss, and if Jesus is not going to make the social distinctions all make, then we lose those meanings by which we label sinners and those who believe free of sin, including ourselves. People don't resist change, they resist loss. And if Jesus is not going to engage in throwing around those suffocating labels that you and I so easily throw around, then we lose our power to declare who is in, who is out, who belongs, and who does not. People don't resist change, they resist loss. And if Jesus is simply going to sit at table and eat with anyone, no questions asked, then what does this do to the pride we take in being part of the in crowd, the notion that membership has its privileges, the prestige we claim in belonging to certain social circles? People don't resist change, they resist loss. That's not exactly the best of news for those of us who wish to follow Jesus, because it appears that in saying yes to Jesus, we at the same time say yes to considerable loss. Loss of much we have always known and believed. Loss of so many of those well-established social norms by which we have sought to control and make predictable our everyday lives. Because it appears, Jesus is not concerned with any of us. Instead, it appears Jesus is concerned with nothing more than sitting at the table with whoever happens to be at table. No judgments. No labels. No designations. No boundaries. No qualifications. No questions asked. All that matters is sitting at table with Jesus. More than food.
Musician, composer, great musician, Ben Niedema, will be here for
part of your ministry. Welcome, worship, and serve your Lord. And Lord, we thank you that you are in the midst of these efforts, blessing all we do for your sake.
Thank you.
Thank you. I didn't stand up. But apparently I should have let you all in. You all look good. We're going to share now a time of prayer with the prayers of the people. As we share in this time of prayer, we're so responsible. That is to say, I'll name various petitions and conclude each with words, Lord, in your mercy. Invite you to be the response to hear our prayer. And invite you as well, name those concerns that you would like to live within this community of faith as we pray together. Include the prayer of Christ as follows. Let us go to God as we pray. We thank you that you have broken through barriers and boundaries, well-established social norms, so as to sit at the table with us. We thank you for your grace and welcomes, blesses, affirms, and receives. We thank you that you turn none of us away. They desire for all of us to come to you, to know your loving, gracious, forgiving embrace. Lord, as we have received this good news from you, so may we be faithful in sharing this good news, welcoming any and all this place and time of worship to your table, knowing that in these acts, though clumsy at times they may be, you are God who is working your purpose out, the God who will have your way. Lord, in your mercy,
in your prayers,
and hear us, Lord, as we pray for the people of this congregation. Lord, in your mercy,
in your prayers.
Lord, in your mercy,
in your prayers.
Hear us as we pray for those who suffer and for those in trouble. Lord, in your mercy,
in your prayers.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Hear us as we pray for the concerns of this community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Are you concerned? Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Hear us as we pray for the world, its peoples, and its leaders. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Lord, hear us as we pray for your church, its leaders, its members, and its mission. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Hear our prayers, joined with the communion of saints that even now surrounds us, gathered every day, singing your praises and praying to Christ's thoughts.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation.
Deliver us from evil.
For thine is the kingdom,
and the power,
and the glory forever.
Amen.
We share our closing hymn as we remember again that we are still making our way through the 40 days of Lent. We stand as we stand. Christ our Lord. He continues to go with us and advise us, make his presence known.